Okay.
Another time.
All right, good morning. Welcome to worship. Today we are celebrating the Lord's love for us. I mean, God has so many character traits that are worthy of our worship, but love is a biggie. And so I want to read to you to start with Psalm 36. It says, "Your love, Lord, reaches to the heavens, your faithfulness to the skies. Your righteousness is like the highest mountains, your justice like the great deep. How priceless is your unfailing love, O God. People take refuge in the shadow of your wings." Would you stand if you're able, and let's sing his praises together. John 3:1 says, "See what great love the Father has lavished on us, that we should be called children of God." And that is what we are.
And 1 John 4:9 through 11 tells us that this is how God showed his love among us. He sent his one and only Son into the world that we might live through him. This is love, not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins. Dear friends, since God so loved us, we also ought to love one another.
Guilty one.
is our heart's cry, Lord. We love you. You have loved us so much. We seek to love you in return. We owe everything to you. Open our hearts to hear what you have to say to us today, loving Father. In Jesus' name, amen.
Everybody doing okay? You guys doing all right this morning? A little bit darker than what I expected when I got up this morning, and that's okay. I got up earlier than I expected this morning. Maybe that was the problem. So anyway, it's good to see you guys this morning. Thank you for being here. Welcome. Welcome to those of you that are joining us online. Appreciate you showing up and being a part of this as well, because it is so good to come together, to worship together. So we are thankful and glad that you are here. If you are new, or if you're visiting with us, my name is Doug Betts, and I am the youth and children's pastor here. And so I want to just extend a warm welcome to you. If this is your first time visiting BFCC, I would encourage you to stop by the Welcome Center. We have a gift we'd like to give you. If you are new, or if you'd like to just find out more about who we are and what's going on in the church, I would encourage you to pick up a bulletin, lots of information about things that are going on in the church. But there's also this really cool response card that you can tear off on the back of the bulletin. In it, you can just fill out whatever. If you have questions, if you'd like to be contacted by a pastor, whatever it may be, you can fill out that response card. On the back side of a response card is a prayer card. If you have something that you would like for us to be praying with you as a church for, just fill that prayer card out, and then you, again, just tear it off, and then you can drop it in one of the two boxes located by the doors as you come into the sanctuary here. We'd love to hear from you. We'd love to be praying with you about whatever it may be that's on your heart. So I'd encourage you to do that. If you have questions, I would encourage you to stop by the Welcome Center and visit with one of the folks there. They can help answer your questions. If they don't have answers, they can at least point you in the right direction. For those of you that are online especially, you can visit our website at beloitfcc.org and find out more about who we are there and what's going on in the life of the church. And then at the end of the service, Pastor Cliff, Pastor Dave, and myself will be available at the doors. We'd love to meet you if we haven't. If you have anything that you like to pray about, we'd love to pray with you at that time. So I would just encourage you during the closing song, if you have something on your heart that you would like to pray about, come on out, and we would just... we'd love to pray with you at that time as the closing song is going. That would be awesome. Just a few things that I want to highlight from the bulletin. A reminder that there is a new Bible study on Elijah. It is a women's Bible study, so all women are invited. It starts today at 4:30. It is in the Family Life Center behind the gym, north classroom, which would be on the right as you're walking back there. But if you have any questions, if you'd like to be a part of it, maybe today doesn't work, but you'd still like to be a part of it, I would encourage you to, you can contact Angela Engelbert. Her information is in the bulletin, if you'd like to be a part of that Bible study. So again, just a reminder on CIY, which is Christ in Youth, for our high school students, which is a camp that we do every summer. We go to different locations. This year we're going to Glorieta, New Mexico, June 24th through the 29th. We're taking a trip. We're taking all these folks that you see on the screen. We'll be going out in the middle of nowhere, and it really is out in the middle of nowhere. If you're not familiar with where Glorieta is, it's going to be in the middle of nowhere. So it's good. It'll be fun. We'll be away from a lot of distractions, and we'll just have a week to focus on learning more about God and our relationship with Him. So if you could be praying for these folks, but also a reminder, as we're raising funds to do that, we will have coming up on March 27th a fundraiser for to help get the students and leaders to move. We'll be doing a breakfast in between services, which take place in the Family Life Center gym. And I would invite every one of you to just come have breakfast. If you don't plan on giving, it's totally okay. I know, that sounds kind of weird for me to say that, but it is totally okay. We would love to have you come and just join us for breakfast, and maybe learn a little bit about what MOVE is and what our high school students will be doing there, and enjoy some really good breakfast served by some high school students and some of their leaders as well. And then a reminder of the Isle Hillman and Cheryl Christian Scholarships, which the church gives out every year. The deadline for that is March 31st. So if you have a college student, or if you are a college student and you would like to apply, there is a little QR code in the bulletin in the middle. It's a little one down here. But you can just scan that with your camera on your phone, and that will take you to a link that you can fill out an application. If you have any questions about that, don't hesitate to come see me, and I can help you get that information done. But the deadline for that is March 31st. And then just a reminder, Wednesday nights, our high school and junior high youth group meet at 7 o'clock. And again, this Wednesday, we are having, I hope I never get tired of saying this, and maybe if this just happens every week, it would be okay, but we're having another baptism. So actually, Zeta Purvis will be getting baptized this week. She was supposed to get baptized 2 weeks ago, but she got sick. So if you could keep Zeta in her prayers, I know that she's really actually nervous, but God is doing some stuff there and stirring some things. But I also know that Satan doesn't like it, and so he's doing his best. So if you could pray for Zeta, as she will be baptized this Wednesday at Fusion. Thanks.
There are plenty of things to be anxious about nowadays. Unexpected health issues, job stress, financial uncertainty, relational conflicts, death or illness of family or friends, and lots of daily life surprises. Unfortunately, worry and anxiety do not go away automatically. We need to consider what the Bible says about worry and anxiety as we prepare for our prayer time as a church family. I invite you to listen as I read Philippians chapter 4, verses 6 and 7, which says, "Do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition with thanksgiving, present your requests to God. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus." What can we learn from these words from Philippians chapter 4? In this passage, God has given us a direct command to not be anxious about anything, but instead to present your request to God, first of all, and then secondly, to offer prayer and supplication with thanksgiving. And if we do that, he promises he will give you peace that transcends understanding, first of all, and secondly, that he will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. These spiritual truths should inspire our prayers to the Lord as a church family. We would do well to remember these truths about God as we pray to him as a church family today. We already have prayer joys and concerns that have been communicated verbally to the pastoral staff, and we have some items that we've received by text and email and online messages. But we welcome other things that you would share right now, not only joys and concerns, but especially testimonies about what God is doing in and through your life. Whatever's on your heart, we want to pray together as a church family about those things. What would you share as a prayer? Joy, concern, or testimony? We welcome the things that are on your heart. Yes, back there. Got it all except what the date is. When is next Sunday, a week from today, March 27th. So we will pray for the FCA dodgeball tournament a week from today, March 27th, at which Dakota and Grace Schertz will be sharing. Thank you for that item that you shared. Appreciate that. Other joys, concerns, and testimonies, we welcome the things that are on your heart, whatever's on your heart. We want to pray together as a church family about those things. I'm going to lead us in prayer in just a minute with a pattern of prayer following the letters of the word pray, P-R-A-Y, in which each of those letters represents a different type or family of prayer, with the P representing praise, R representing repent, A representing ask, and Y representing yield. I'm going to offer some suggestions as I'm praying, but I want to encourage you to pray on your own heart, however God prompts you. Join me in your hearts as I lead us in prayer. Praise. As we begin in our prayer time, I invite you to express your own praise and devotion to God in your own heart, however He prompts you. God in heaven, we hope in your character. You alone are ruler and master. You are holy, loving, and sovereign. The praise team reminded us of your amazing love, and we know that you alone are eternal and everlasting. We worship you in this service today. There's none other like you. We praise you with our lives. We lift our hands in your name. Praise God, praise God. Repent. As we continue on in our prayer time, I invite you to talk to God in your own heart about your own life, however He prompts you. Ephesians 1:7 reminds us, in Him we have redemption through His blood, the forgiveness of sins in accordance with the riches of God's grace. We need that promise. I need that promise. Therefore, God, I confess my sin, and I repent, and I seek your mercy, washing, and cleansing. I realize that it's only by the blood of Jesus that I have any hope of forgiveness and cleansing. I realize that I don't deserve it. I can't earn it. I can't pay it back. It's just by grace. Ask. As we continue on in our prayer time, I invite you to talk to God in your own heart, asking Him whatever He prompts you in your heart. Thank you for allowing us to share in our journey of faith as a church family. Thank you that we're not alone, but that we can be encouraging and be encouraged as part of a church family. And thank you for each individual, because each is valuable and significant and important, created in your image. Help us to see one another the way you see us. We praise you, God, along with Jim Gates, for the great doctor's report of remission of his medical concerns, and we continue to pray for him that you would show yourself strong on all that is on his behalf. We give you praise for the ladies who attended the Women's Encounter of the Cross event last weekend. We thank you for the encouragement and inspiration and challenge that was shared, and we pray that it will continue to work in the lives of those who were able to participate. We give you praise for the Heart Choices Banquet coming March 31st, and we pray for many people in the area to be able to participate and learn more about and support this local mission. God, we also ask for your help, hope, and healing for all those for whom we pray. We pray along with Renee Mason for the FCA dodgeball tournament a week from today, March 27th, and we pray there'll be a positive experience, an uplifting time, and we pray for the sharing of Dakota and Schertz and his wife as they give testimony about your work in and through their spiritual journey. We pray that it would be a positive experience for those who can participate. We pray along with Dean Jones for his sister, Dee, in Wisconsin, as she had a stroke and is in the hospital. Help her, we pray. We pray for Mike Jones as he went to Kansas City on Friday, March 18th, to start to receive treatment for water around his heart and other heart tests that will be going on for several days. We pray for him in this ongoing heart concern that has been a challenge for a period of time. We pray for Bill File as he heals and recovers after successful cataract surgery last week. Help him, we pray. Show yourself strong on his behalf. We pray along with Lorelei Dahl for her sister Jennifer in Chicago as she continues in hospice care, and for her brother Art as he learned that his cancer is spreading. Be with each of these of her family members to help and guide and support them. Our prayers continue for Ron Pontier as he continues his ongoing battle with cancer and the new treatment program. Be with him, we pray. We pray for the situation in Ukraine, for safety for Christians and for missionaries, and for a peaceful solution to be found for the conflict there. God in heaven, we pray for Pastor Cliff as he shares your word today. Fill him, anoint him, use him, allow him to be a channel of your truth, and may your spirit be present to prompt the heart of each one, both here and online, regarding whatever the next step is for each of us on our spiritual journey. We all have different journeys, but we all have a next step, and we pray for your help, whatever that next step may be. God, we want to pray for the families of those who have experienced passing of loved ones. We pray for the family of Kimberly Eck-Jermark, as her funeral was March 15th. And we pray for the family of Brian Greenwell's mom, as she passed away in California last week. We pray for safe travel for Brian and Jennifer. We pray for the family of Jean Rose, as her funeral was Friday, March 18th in Ionia. Send comfort and peace, we pray. And we pray for the family of Diana Glauser, Susan Eilert's sister-in-law, as that funeral was Saturday, March 19th. For each of these families, send comfort and peace and prompt us to be your hands, your feet, your words, to reach out to support and encourage those who have experienced loss that they may not be alone. Yield. As we continue on in our prayer time, I invite you to talk to God in your own heart, yielding to him however he prompts you. This is my prayer of surrender. I choose to not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, I will, by prayer and petition with thanksgiving, present my request to you, God. And I trust that the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard my heart and my mind in Christ Jesus. Thank you for hearing these prayers. I pray in the precious name of Jesus, my risen Lord, Master, and Savior. Amen.
Welcome, church, and those online. This is our communion time. We have an open table, so as long as you've accepted Christ into your heart, you're more than welcome to participate. After my prayer, come forward. We have two cups, one with the wafer and one with juice to represent Christ's body on the cross that was sacrificed for our sins. We have two baskets on either side to dispose of your cups when you're finished. And if you need assistance, we have a couple deacons. Myself can help you if you want to remain at your seats. We also have in the back, by the back doors, we have two baskets for your tithes and offerings as the Holy Spirit directs you to give this morning. This time of year is the time that we spend a lot more time on the screen than any other time of the year. I know I do. It's, of course, March Madness. Basketball, NCAA Division I tournament time. You know, we read about all the billions of hours of lost productivity, and I might be one of those. All the billions of dollars spent on gambling. I was reading there was the chance of filling out, this is unbelievable, I thought would be in the millions or billions, but the chances of filling out a perfect bracket is one in 9.22 quintillion. And I'm a social studies teacher, but you know, that's a lot of zeros. And mine was broken the first game. But anyway, I was intrigued by an article I read Thursday as I was prepping to watch the South Dakota Providence game. And they came close, Renee, but not quite. And though we can get really caught up in the madness, I don't want to dwell on the negative, we can actually glean some important spiritual aspects from the tournament. Now, I have three things here real briefly. Number one, we all want to be part of something bigger than ourselves. Over 70 million brackets will be filled out this season. And to put that in perspective, former President Obama won his first election and received 66 million votes. Back in 2012, so that was interesting to me. As Christians, we can be part of God's great commission and on his team working with fellow believers, reaching the lost. And when those do come to the fold, we get to celebrate, just like we do during tournament time. Number two, many of us are indeed hopeful that our favorite team might make it to the final dance or the final game. We can be hopeful by being on God's team. We will know, we already know about that final game, and we know the final results of that game, especially when we're on God's team. Our hope rests on God's promise that will be fulfilled. Peter wrote in 1 Peter 1, verse 13, "Therefore, with minds that are alert and fully sober, set your hope on the grace to be brought to you when Christ Jesus is revealed at his coming." And then finally, number three, third point here is we always seem to love, especially in America, we always seem to love the underdog. The lower seeds knocking off the upper seeds, unless, of course, your favorite team is a number one or number two seed. And we see this in the Bible. We see this in characters like Moses, who we read was not a very good public speaker. And, of course, my favorite underdog story was David versus Goliath. That would have been probably what the equivalent of a number 16 taking on a number one. But I don't know about that, because with God being on David's side, there's more number one taking on Goliath, who was number 16. But anyway, we like to see the underdog succeed. But the best success story this morning, as we come before the table, is when humanity, because of our sin, had no chance of success in getting back to God's good grace. No chance. Because of the sin of Adam and Eve. But Jesus comes as an underdog, not as a conquering king, not as a conquering basketball team or a conquering victorious coach, but he came as a servant, dying a sacrificial death and rising from the tomb. Through repentance and faith, we get to participate in this great exchange. And we are reminded of this each and every Sunday as we come before the communion table. Deacons, please. Heavenly gracious Father, we thank you this morning for the wonderful opportunity to be accepted into your kingdom through the sacrificial gift of your Son 2,000 years ago. We remember this as we come before the communion table. We pray this in Christ's name. Amen.
Good morning, church. Thanks for coming out and worshiping with us today. We are really pleased to see you and to do this together. We're glad to look into God's Word together also. And so if you have a Bible, want to get right to it this morning. We're looking at Matthew, the Gospel of Matthew chapter 7. And we're looking at verses 1 through 6. So just a short passage here. We're in a series that's going to go throughout this Lenten series season that is looking at questions that Jesus asked. And we're looking at these questions so that we can go deeper. One of the goals of the season of Lent is really being able to look at our lives, look at the sin that still happens within our lives, but to go deeper with that, not to be content with that. And one of the ways that Jesus helps us is to ask us questions. He knows the answers, but we don't until we start asking and really pondering them. And so we've got, he'll have two questions in this, but I'm going to condense it into one question today. You can see what I'm going to do here in just a bit. So follow along Matthew 7, 1 through 6. This is God's Word. And so we give thanks to God. And we remember that the Holy Spirit inspired this text, so it's the inspired Word of God. So let's listen for the Holy Spirit who's present here today to speak to us, to teach us, and to guide us. This is God's Word. Jesus is speaking. Do not judge, or you too will be judged. For in the same way you judge others, you will be judged. And with the measure you use, it will be measured to you. Why do you look at the speck of sawdust in your brother's eye and pay no attention to the plank in your own eye? How can you say to your brother, "Let me take the speck out of your eye," when all the time there is a plank in your own eye? You hypocrite, first take the plank out of your own eye, and then you will see clearly to remove the speck from your brother's eye. Do not give dogs what is sacred. Do not throw your pearls to pigs. If you do, they may trample them under their feet and turn and tear you to pieces. Let's take a moment to pray. We ask for your help, Father. We ask that your Holy Spirit would move among us. Help us not to resist you. Lord, we know every work that you do is good. Even if it's difficult, we know it's always for our very best. And so help us to receive what you would speak to us today, knowing your love and knowing that if we receive what you would say, that you would change us. We pray that would happen. We pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. So again, I think if you look at this text, you see right away, it's like you're looking for the question that Jesus asks, and he asks really two questions. Why do you look at the speck in your brother's eye? And then he asks, how can you say to your brother, "Let me get that speck out," when you've got a plank in your eye? But I'm going to condense those today. So our question for the day here is, why do you judge? Why do you judge? Jesus is giving us a picture, I think, of what it looks like to judge, have a plank in my eye trying to take a speck out of someone else's eye, but really to go deeper on this question, what's happening inside my heart, your heart, that would prompt us at some point, at various times in a day, throughout the week, to look at other people and see the smallest thing wrong in their life and miss big stuff that's happening in our own. Why do we do that? Now, one of the interesting things about this text to me is that this is actually one of the most quoted verses in the entire Bible, including people who don't even believe the Bible is true, but this verse gets whipped out in a hurry. And it's used often, I think, when someone feels like you're about to disagree with them. You're about to say that you don't believe that what they believe is true or right. And right away, we just say, hey, don't judge. Don't judge. And if they want to get real spiritual about it. They'll go to King James Version. They'll say, "Judge ye not, lest ye be judged." Well, thank you for offering that very wise advice. Don't judge me. Don't speak against anything that I'm doing or believing, because if you're doing that, it means you're judging. So this verse gets used a lot. It's kind of a defensive mode. Don't judge. And I think one of the reasons is because our culture thinks about this verse in terms of the word tolerance, which is a really high value in our culture. Now, don't get nervous with that word, because I hear a lot of times, you know, oh, the culture is all about tolerance. And from a Christian point of view, a lot of people just kind of dismiss it then. But understand that the Bible actually calls Christians to the highest level of tolerance. Accept one another then, as Christ accepted you. Accept the one whose faith is weak without quarreling over disputable matters. And it's not just with brothers and sisters. We're called to a great tolerance of enemies. So when your enemy curses you, what does the Bible say? Bless them. When someone curses you, you bless them. When someone persecutes you, what's the Bible say? Pray for them. This is the highest level of tolerance possible, that a very person who's coming against you, who is even persecuting you, that you would then say, if my enemy is hungry or thirsty, I'm going to give him something to eat and something to drink. So on this one level, don't just abandon that word, because the Bible calls us to a high, high aspect of tolerance. But I think generally what the culture wants to attach to it is the idea that, hey, my truth is not your truth. Your truth is not my truth. And the kind of a relativism. And yes, we certainly don't want to buy into that idea that there is no absolute truth. Don't tell me my beliefs and actions are wrong. That means you're being really, really intolerant. You're judging me. Which, by the way, is the ultimate paradox. Because if someone ever tells you that you are being judgmental and intolerant, guess what they're doing? They're actually judging you for being intolerant. There's really no way around it. When we talk about judging, what we're saying here is, yes, there's a bad kind of judging that Jesus makes it really clear. Don't judge. And think about why you do that. But there's going to be judgments that have to be made, decisions and understandings and what I would call discernment. Am I understanding? Am I seeing this rightly? And we're always doing this. Even the most relativistic person ends up making judgments. We can't get away from that. But part of the problem is when we make a judgment, and maybe we, you know, this is the season of Lent, season of confession, season of repentance. And so I think we should, as Christians, own up that we don't always do this well. That it's not just that we disagree, but it's how we disagree. That, I mean, I'm just, for myself, I know I do this. Because when I get into an argument or a disagreement or a debate of some kind, there's, I don't know what clicks on. Maybe it's my sports background or something. I get really competitive, and my primary issue at that point is I want to win this argument. When Jesus is saying, well, what I want you to do is love this person. Yes, there are going to be disagreements, but how we do it. And we have not always done that well as Christians. And one of the reasons that non-Christians find it very, very difficult to even think about coming to a church or connecting and getting closer to God is because they've experienced a spiritual beatdown by Christians. And so we just confess that. That's wrong. Jesus says, don't judge. I know this doesn't get much traction, but I'm pushing for a law to be passed. Never gets past the legislature, but here's the law. If you end up having a conversation with someone and you deeply disagree about something, the law ought to be that you have to go out and have pie together afterwards. That ought to be a law, right? And if you find that you're in agreement with somebody, the law ought to say within 24 hours, you got to go find somebody that you disagree with and then go out and have pie together. I mean, I really think that there's something about the fact that can I really be honest and share and talk and have a give and take with somebody where they fundamentally disagree with me and not distance myself from the relationship? Like not retreat back into our own comfortable camp of people who all agree and think the way that I do, but instead be a people of salt and light in the world, who are out there in the world. And yes, we have these disagreements, but at no point could everyone question, but do they love me? Do they care about me, or do they care about winning the argument? I mean, I confess, I think this is partly what Jesus is getting at when he says, don't judge. Don't have this mentality that absolutely hurts people in the name of the truth. But if you're going to speak the truth in love, as the scriptures would say. So we confess this. 1 Peter 3:15, we love that verse. I love that verse. 1 Peter 3:15, if anyone asks the reason for the hope you have, be prepared to give an answer for the reason for the hope that you have. But then we always leave off the end part of that verse. We like that first part. Be prepared. I'm prepared. I'm ready. I've got the guns loaded and ready. If anybody has any questions about Jesus, I'm going to be able to shoot them down and say, look, I win. But it says at the end of 1 Peter 3:15, and do this with gentleness and respect. Gentleness and respect. How much gentleness do we see in our culture? Gentleness and respect. Not relativism, not holding back the truth, but can I do it with gentleness and respect? By what we know that Jesus is not giving this blanket statement about never ever judge, because it's always context. We say when you're reading your Bible, the most important thing that you can do, there's lots of Bible helps, use every law that you can, but the best help you have is the Bible itself interprets the Bible. It helps you. But the way you do that is you have to look at context. So instead of just taking one verse, you start to take your lens, your view, and you kind of start to expand it. So I'm looking not just this verse that says, do not judge, but I'm going to expand it. What's the context of this passage in Matthew 7? Well, if you expand that context out just a little bit, you'll see in the same chapter, a little bit later on, Jesus is going to make it clear, you better make good judgments. So do not judge, but here's some context. But you're also going to need judgment because you need to watch out for false prophets. So this is Matthew 7, 15 and 20. Watch out for false prophets. By their fruit, you will recognize them, which is another way to say you make a judgment about someone. He says, don't just judge on the outside, but judge by how they live, the fruit of their life. So he's saying, draw this context. Oh, so there is a good kind of judging, a necessary kind of discernment that needs to happen in life. Don't judge. There's something there, but also as you take the context. And if you go back even a little bit further, the context of this passage, Matthew 7, is actually part of a really, really long teaching. It runs from Matthew chapter 5. So if you pull your context lens back, you see Matthew chapter 5, Jesus begins to preach. We call it the Sermon on the Mount. And it covers three chapters in Matthew, Matthew 5, 6, and 7. We're reading Matthew 7 here. And if you look at that context, you'll see Jesus teaches his disciples how to be salt and light in the world, how to use good deeds so that people glorify our Father in heaven. And when you get to chapter 6, Jesus begins to then say, so when you're out there being salt and light and you're doing your acts of righteousness, and then he begins to kind of go through several different things. He says, but when you give, give, but don't give like the hypocrites. They like to be seen when they give because they like to get people's approval and applause. He says, when you pray, this is Matthew 6 still, he says, pray, but don't pray like the hypocrites. You start to see this kind of pattern, this repetition that Jesus uses. Pray, but not like hypocrites. Fast, yes, do your fasting, but don't fast like hypocrites. And when you see this context, this is all right before our passage here in Matthew 7. You get to Matthew 7, and then you can see what Jesus is saying. Don't judge. Yes, you're going to have to judge sometimes, but don't judge like the hypocrites. That's what he says. He actually says it in verse 5 there. Don't judge like the hypocrites. Okay, so what is hypocritical judging? Let me take you out a little bit further, out of our passage here. A couple verses that I think give two really good pictures of what hypocritical judging is. One is from John 7:24, where Jesus says, stop judging by mere appearances, but instead judge correctly. And then in Romans chapter 2, you therefore have no excuse, you who pass judgment on someone else, for at whatever point you judge another, you are condemning yourself, because you who pass judgment do the same thing. So that tells me there's at least two kinds of hypocritical kinds of judging. One is judging by mere appearances, and one is judging selectively or kind of out of proportion. So maybe the first one with appearances. Judging by appearances. This is the old proverb, you know, don't judge a book by its cover, which is not in the Bible, but it's a pretty good saying, right? Don't judge a book by its cover. Don't judge by just these outward external appearances. I was reading this really interesting account. A man who lived in a major city, he says he was riding on a bus, and he says, as I'm sitting on this bus, he said, there's a man sitting there, and he's got a little three-year-old. Now, three-year-olds can get pretty precocious. I've got a couple three-year-old grandchildren, and they're full of energy, and they do all kinds of stuff. And he said, this man was just sitting there, though, just not doing anything. And his three-year-old was running up and down the aisles of the bus and hitting people and screaming and hollering. And he said, and the man just sat there, just kind of a blank expression on his face, did nothing. He said, finally, an older gentleman got up, went over to the man, and he said, you need to do something with your son. He's out of control. And he said, then he heard this response. And so he said, when the man came over to the guy, the guy kind of snapped out of his kind of daze. And he said to him, I'm so sorry. He said, my wife has been really sick in the hospital. I just got word that she died. And now I'm trying to figure out how am I going to tell my three-year-old that his mama's dead. And I don't know how to say it. And I just kind of, wow. Because when I was hearing this story, I was like, yeah, somebody needs to get this guy. Someone needs to really let him know. You can't let your son just... But boy, when you know, and of course, we see this all the time, don't we? I mean, we run into each other all the time, and I have no idea what you've been through. I don't know what you're struggling with right now. But God, help me not to judge just by appearances. Help me to get beyond that kind of that superficial way of saying, oh, this is what must be happening, when I don't have near the information. Jesus says, don't judge by mere appearances. Sometimes we judge selectively. So for this example, I would kind of point to, here's another phrase that's not in the Bible, but it's a good phrase, never say never. Never say never. I think that's probably a good thing to think about, because I see that with the Apostle Peter. Peter, you know, who's real rambunctious, and he's just kind of, he puts it all out there. If he's thinking it, it's going to be out there. In Matthew 16, Jesus gathers his disciples, and he says to them, guys, who do people say that I am? Well, some people say this, and some people say, no, who do you say I am? And Peter gets the right answer. The only time he ever gets the right answer, and he nails it, he goes, oh, you are the Christ, you are the Son of the living God. And Jesus goes, man, Peter, you are blessed. Because this is information, knowledge given to you, revealed to you. You didn't come up with it, but it's been given to you by the Holy Spirit. And then right after that, Jesus says to him, now that you know who I am, I have to tell you, I'm going to Jerusalem, and I'm going to be handed over to the religious leaders, and they're going to brutalize me. They are going to torture me, and they're going to kill me. And then I'm going to rise from the dead. They can't hear the last part, because all they can hear is the impossible thing. No, if you're the true Messiah King, the Messiah King did not come to die, he came to conquer. You can't possibly do this. Everyone's thinking it, but Peter, of course, is bold enough to actually, and I love the way it says this in Matthew 16, it says he takes Jesus aside. This is great, don't you think? Because this is sensitivity on Peter's part. I don't want to embarrass Jesus on this. I don't want to embarrass the eternal word and wisdom of God, or God Almighty, in front of the other disciples. So Jesus, just for a second, come over here. And Peter says, this will never happen. I will not let this happen, Jesus. Whatever you're talking about, I'm telling you right now, this will never happen. And Jesus, who's just said, oh, you are so blessed, now has to turn around and say, get behind me, Satan. Man, you got the things of men in your mind, not the things of God. And then later on, Jesus, Peter still hasn't really learned his lesson, because at the Last Supper, the night that Jesus is going to be betrayed and arrested, he says to him, guess what? One of you is going to betray me, but all of you are going to leave me. All of you are going to flee. You're going to run away, abandon me. And Peter says again, look, Jesus, these bozos might. I get it. I mean, I understand. I've been walking with these guys for 3 years too, and they're not much to look at. But I'm telling you, even if they all abandon you, I will, what does he say? Never going to do it. Never say never. It's a sign that what's happening internally is I'm judging. I'm making a judgment, but that's not a right judgment. You know, before I was a parent, I was the best parent in the world. I just want you to know I had that title. I was the best parent in the world before I became an actual parent, because I would have this, I had this hypocritical judging that I would do, because I would see other parents with kids and they're struggling. You know, it's a battle out there every single day, but I would watch them and I'd be like, when I'm a parent, I will never do that. I will never do that. Because I'd see them and they'd be, man, they're just being too harsh. And, you know, you get into all the stuff you've ever read, and you're not a parent yet, but you've read everything. And so, well, what good does it do to discipline a child with the very bad behavior that you're trying to discipline them for? You're showing a terrible example as an adult to a child. You can't discipline them that way. And besides that, you've got to make sure that they understand that if they've done something bad, it doesn't make them a bad person. They've made bad choices, and that they are really a child of God, and to fill them up with love. Then you become a parent, right? I have three daughters, and at some point in life, they make some bad choices. I sit them down, and with great sensitivity, I'm like, hey, you're not a bad person, but this is a really bad choice. So I just want you to understand, hey, are you listening to me right now? I'm telling you, this is a bad choice, and it doesn't mean that I don't love you. You're still loved of God. You're a child of, hey, what do you mean that I don't understand? Yes, I understand completely. This is a really bad choice that you're making, and it's because I love you that I'm going to discipline you. I just want you to know that. And what do you mean that I'm not being consistent? Well, that was different with your sister. Don't worry about that. I'm just telling you right now that you need to know that you're going to be disciplined. Don't talk back to me right now. I think you should go to your room right now. And don't stomp. And I'm telling you, do not slam that bedroom door. If you slam that bedroom door, with God as my witness, I will take it off its hinges and I will burn your bedroom door and you will have no bedroom door anymore. And bam, slam goes the door. Man, just never say never. Because the moment that I say, I would never do that. And it goes beyond just that area, of course. I can't tell you how many times, and it breaks my heart, because I'm a pastor and I'm in ministry, when I see a ministry leader that I have loved and respected and learned from and grown from in their ministry take a huge fall. You read about it all the time. I read about it. And there's that, Jesus is saying, why do I do this? Think about this, he says. There's a part of me that wants to say, I can't believe they did that. Why, I would never do that. See where we're at? Jesus says, think about this. How could he do that? I would never. Galatians 6:1 says, brothers and sisters, if someone is caught in a sin, you who live by the Spirit should restore that person gently, but watch yourselves. Watch yourselves, or you also may be tempted. I'm really no better. This is something that God's been working on me. It's like, wherever you see somebody fall, Cliff, I want you to make sure that you can see yourself doing that. And I fight against that, because I want to tell God, there's no way. I would never do that. Never say never, Cliff. You don't understand their situation. If I had you in the exact same context, your sin is enough to do that. And you begin to kind of feel, is that really true? I think another warning sign for that is, I think we tend to unleash our harshest criticism because we have unresolved sin in our own life. You mean people who have railed against a particular sin, and then it comes out they were actually engaging in it while they were railing against it? Doesn't that tell us that what our heart wants to do is, when I refuse to actually openly confess it, get it dealt with repentance, have the Holy Spirit clear that, not to get saved all over again. You don't lose your salvation, but you have the security of God's grace in which you can say, I can be honest that I am messed up and I've got this problem. This is a sin. And when I don't do that, you know what happens? You and I start to hate ourselves. There's a self-loathing that takes place. I hate that I do this. And because we're not getting it resolved by the grace of God, you know what? The only thing you can do with that anger is pour it out, and then it gets dumped on others. Oh, God, when I am most critical of others, could it be that you're actually highlighting, Cliff, you haven't dealt with this sin? Deal with this sin. Jesus says this kind of judgmental hierarchy of sins, well, some sins are worse than others, gets us into deep, deep trouble. And it usually means that we have a distorted view because of our judgmentalism. So distorted that I can't tell the difference between a plank and a speck. So what's the answer here? Why do you judge? Let me go back to that, verses 3, 5, and 6. There is a healing that I think that comes from through humility, a healing of pride. Why do you, and then Jesus says, pay no attention to the plank in your own eye. Why do you pay no attention? Pride is not paying attention to the plank or the condition of my own sin. It's not paying attention to it. It's not thinking about it. Hey, I thought Jesus died for all my sins. I don't have to think about that anymore. Jesus says, you're not really paying attention. Humility is knowing about the plank. Do you know about your plank? Do I know about my plank that's in my eye? We think about eternal life. Eternal life is not just a ticket to heaven. Eternal life is new life, and it makes you alive to things that you were deadened to before, and it gives you a vision that you didn't have before, new sight. You begin to appreciate. So eternal life is not just I get this ticket to heaven, it's this God, I get to see who God is, and God is beautiful and powerful, and I want to be like Him. I have a new vision of God's holiness and power and His grace and His truth and His goodness and His love, and you see the worth of God. I actually think that's why these kind of weird phrases that Jesus uses at the end about the pig and the pearls and the dogs is really about this idea of being able to see when I couldn't see before what was really worth, what has great worth in this life. Jesus actually gives two parables in the book of Matthew about pearls. One is here in Matthew 7. Don't throw your pearls before swine, he says. And one's in Matthew 13, where he gives a very brief parable about a man who, to put it into our vernacular, is going from garage sale to garage sale, and he buys a painting that turns out to be a masterpiece worth millions. He finds, in the most unexpected place, he finds something of great worth, a pearl of great price, is what that parable talks about. And the worth of goodness and goodness of God is what this is referencing. The worth and goodness of the gospel. Can I really see its worth? That it has great worth and value above all else. The worth and goodness of Jesus is always there, but we don't always recognize it because of the plank, unresolved sin in my life. In sin, we become more like dogs and pigs. Well, what about dogs and pigs? They want to be filled. A dog and a pig wants their belly filled. That's their primary movement throughout the whole day, their primary motivation. What's my motivation today? I want to get my belly filled. It's not that animals can't see the pearls. It's not that they're blind to them. They see them. They just say, that's not going to fill me. That's not going to give me what I really want. And therefore, whatever people might say, that's great worth and great value, those pearls, means nothing. Means nothing to us unless we can see the actual worth. It's sort of like, it's very much like a person. This happens a lot. Somebody comes close to Jesus. They hear us talking about, hey, give your life to Christ. Surrender your life to Christ. And the thought process for a lot of people, I think almost most of us probably, when we first start hearing about Jesus, is this. Christianity, okay. So if I go to church, if I pray, if I try to obey the Ten Commandments as best I can, if I follow the example of Jesus, that means he'll make my life go just right, right? That's kind of the deal. He'll fill me then. He'll give me what I really want as long as I do some of these spiritual religious things. See, the pearl is beautiful and valuable, but to a dog or a pig, it's just saying, is it useful? And sometimes people come to Jesus and they don't see his beauty and his worth. They just say, well, can he help me get what I really want? Can I use Jesus to get what I really want? And you don't have to be someone who's just coming to Jesus. Guess what? Even if you've walked with Jesus a long time, our hearts can revert right back and say, I'm in this great bargain with Jesus. I show up for church, he's going to bless me. I pray, he's going to protect me. And it's sort of this great bargain. I do a little bit for God, he does a little bit for me. And somewhere along the line in there, you absolutely lose complete sight of the great worth and value of who God is in himself. The gospel itself loses its worth. And so Jesus is trying to say here, look, when you come with the gospel to other people, yes, don't judge. Don't judge on mere appearances. But also, when you present the gospel to them, understand, have a sensitivity, the same sensitivity that you would have when it comes to getting something out of your eye. Have you ever really had something in your eye? Almost most of us have. I mean, it's painful, right? Do you ever have somebody who's offered to help you get that out of your eye? For me, it's usually my wife. You got something in your eye. Let me get that out. And you're like, wait, hold on a second, you know? I mean, she's coming hard. She's driving hard to the hoop. And I'm just like, wait, you know, I mean, let me see if I can get this out. Because why? Because you're a little bit afraid that, hey, this is a really highly sensitive area of my life here. And you can't just go poking around in there. I mean, bad things can happen. And so you're kind of hesitant because I don't want to get hurt by the very person who says they want to help me. Do you see the parallel here for Jesus when he says, so when we present the gospel, when we say, I have a pearl of great price, Jesus Christ, and I want him, I want you to have him. He says, but are you recognizing where they're at? Because if you just keep throwing this at them, and you say, I did my duty, I did evangelism, I shared the gospel, without any sensitivity, it's like throwing pearls before swine. He's saying they can't even use it. Have you recognized where they're at in life? And maybe one of the best ways to recognize that is when we share the gospel, we share our story. It says, when you throw your pearls, it's your story. When you come to others and you say, look, I want to share with you that I was lost, that I am lost in my sin without Jesus. And you begin to share your brokenness. See, because if somebody has already been through the pain of having something in their eye, I'm a lot more inclined to let them begin to poke around. Because why? Because they know how bad it hurts. They understand the context. They come with a sensitivity and a carefulness that I appreciate. And people can't hear the gospel a lot of times because we're just lobbing pearls at them instead of saying, look, I know what it's like to be empty. Let me share with you my brokenness. And when we begin to do that, oh, it's moving away from this judgmental heart. It's very interesting. What that means to me is we really begin to take a new approach in the way that we interact with people, including the way that we hold non-Christians, or we try to. You ever know this? We do this sometimes. We try to hold non-Christians to Christian morality. Like we expect them to live up to Christian morality, even though they're not in Christ. They haven't received Christ. Yeah, but you still ought to live this way. It's like throwing pearls. Paul puts this very bluntly in 1 Corinthians 5. Talk about judging. He says, what business is it of mine to judge those outside the church? In other words, he's saying, I have zero business judging people outside the church. None. God's going to judge those outside. He's going to judge those inside. God's the judge here, he says. What business is it of mine? Not to hold non-Christians to Christian standards of morality, because here's our mission. Our mission is not to try to get people to be a little bit better morally. That's a really dangerous path, because if they start hearing that, all we're peddling is religion. Oh, be a better person. Live this way. Do this. What we have to do is say the pearl of great price is this. You need a new heart before you can have new behavior. And what we're calling people to do is to be born again by the Spirit of God. After they're born again and given a new heart, then, yes, the changes in behavior take place. And it's a slow process, but not until then. If I try to have people become better morally before they get to that point, I'm in danger of making them impervious to the gospel. I'm a pretty good person. I do good things. Actually, none of us are. Why do I judge? Here's the primary reason. Because I have forgotten. Do this in remembrance of me. This is exactly right. The reason I judge is when I forget that I am the pig, that I am the dog. And it's very interesting. Jesus, when he's on the cross, do you remember what he says on the cross? He says, my God, why have you forsaken me? He's hanging on the cross, dying. And he's actually quoting from Psalm 22. If you get a chance this afternoon, read Psalm 22. It's a Psalm of David, but it's so interesting. It's really a prophecy, because when you read through it, it describes Jesus' crucifixion at a time in history when crucifixions were not taking place. David writes this deeply painful description, and Jesus takes it as his own. He says, that's me. He begins to quote it on the cross. My God, why have you forsaken me? That's how Psalm 22:1 begins, but it goes on and it says this. Many bulls surround me. Strong bulls of Bashan encircle me. Roaring lions that tear their prey open their mouths wide against me. Dogs surround me. A pack of villains encircles me. They pierce my hands and my feet. And the whole psalm talks about how Jesus is torn to shreds. And he uses imageries of dogs in here. So when Jesus is saying, you cast your pearl before the swine, and we get this judgmental attitude and say, yeah, see, they won't receive Jesus. They're so stubborn and so full of sin, they won't receive Jesus. And Jesus is saying, don't you know that it was your sin that tore me to shreds? So when that comes home, and I stop thinking of other people as dogs and pigs, and I start thinking of it was my sin that tore him to shreds because I did not see the worth of the gospel. I didn't see the worth of Jesus. And because of that, but he did this willingly. He says, I'm going to willingly offer my life for you because I'm going to heal you of your pride. And it's not going to be this debasing kind of thing. I'm going to lift you up, but not based on that you're somehow better than anybody else, because you know it was your sin that put me on this cross. Now you go and tell others that, and you won't be casting pearls before swine. You go and tell others that, and you won't be judging others superficially or in any other bad way. Tell them it was your sin that tore me to shreds. But I did it because I love you. I did it so that you could be rescued and saved. Let's pray. It's hard to think about that, God. I mean, we really judge ourselves in a way that we don't think our sin was that bad. And then your word comes to us and reminds us again. it requires your death. And because you did it willingly, you offered yourselves for us, God, it causes us to be born again, to have a new heart with new desires, and suddenly new vision, that we actually get to see how beautiful and amazing and powerful and graceful you are. God, as our love for you would grow then, we pray that you would drive out of each one of us all pride. God, that we would have joy, the joy of our salvation, the joy of being that loved. God, that we can take out to the world. And even if they don't receive it, God, we pray that you would give them the grace of new sight, just as you gave to us, undeservedly. We recognize that. We confess that now. And we pray, God, you send us out as a humble, joyful people, that others would be drawn to you. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. So let's worship God. We've got a closing song here. We have opportunities to pray. So while people are singing, we'll be available here at the doors. Don't hesitate. Just come on out. Let's stand. Let's worship God today.